JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's weekly market outlook webinar for the week June the 28th until July the 2nd. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will describe the most important economic releases and events on the financial agenda for the week ahead. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer first. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, there is no central bank meeting this week, but we will get to hear from several ECB and Fed policymakers, from whom we may get more hints and clues as to how they tend to move forward in terms of monetary policy. As for the data, Eurozone CPIs are coming out, as well as the US employment report for June. Now let's take things from the beginning though. Today there are no top tier data releases on the financial agenda, and thus market participants are likely to pay attention to the scheduled speakers. According to the economic calendar, we have three ECB, two Fed, and one Bank of England officials scheduled to speak today. From the ECB, we will get to hear from Vice President Luis de Guindos, Executive Board Member Fabio Panetta, and Governing Council Member Jens Wittmann. Despite headline inflation in the Eurozone rising to 2%, President Christine Lagarde and Chief Economist Philip Lane have repeatedly pushing back against the inflation is back narrative, supporting that it's not time to consider withdrawing monetary policy support yet. So with that in mind, it would be interesting to see whether other members of the bank hold the same view. Excuse me. In our view, with underlying inflation still staying at 0.9% year over year, we believe that the new speakers will agree with Lagarde and Philip Lane, which may allow investors of European equities to increase somewhat their exposure. At the same time, the euro may come under some additional selling pressure. Now, in case a member holds a different view, suggesting that they may have to consider scaling back stimulus at an earlier point in time, we may have the opposite market reaction, meaning a higher euro and a pullback in European stocks. From the Fed, we have New York President John Williams and Board Governor Randall Quartz. We've already heard from Williams, and we know that he's against withdrawing monetary policy support too soon. He said that data and conditions have not progressed enough for the FOMC to shift its monetary policy stance, adding that the discussion about raising interest rates is still way off in the future. Although Fed Chief Powell shares a similar view, some other members like Dallas President Kaplan, St. Louis President Bullard, and Atlanta President Bostic believe that interest rates will need to start rising as soon as next year. Therefore, we are eager to find out in which camp does Governor Quarles belongs. More support that the committee should start scaling back quantitative easing soon and that interest rates may need to start rising as early as next year could result in another setback in equities and another rebound in the US dollar. As for Bank of England Chief Economist Andy Haldane, we know that last week he was the only one to support scaling back quantitative easing, but this was his last monetary policy meeting, so whatever he says today may have a limited impact as it cannot affect the decision of his former colleagues. Now on Tuesday, On Tuesday, during the Asian session, we get Japan's jobs data for May. The unemployment rate is expected to have ticked up to 2.9% from 2.8%, while the jobs to applications ratio is forecast to have ticked down to 1.08 from 1.09. Later in the day, Germany's preliminary CPIs for June are due to be released. Both the CPI and the HICP rates are forecast to have declined to 2.3% year-over-year from 2.1%. Both the CPI and the HICP rates are forecast to have declined to 2.3% year-over-year and 2.1% year-over-year from 2.5 and 2.4 respectively. Something that may raise speculation that Eurozone's headline inflation due out on Wednesday may slow down as well. From the US, we get the Conference Board Consumer Confidence Index for the same month, which is expected to have risen to 119 from 117.2. Now, on Wednesday, the main item on the agenda may be Eurozone's preliminary CPIs for June. The headline CPI rate is expected to have ticked down to 1.9% year-over-year from 2% year-over-year, while the HICP, excluding energy and food, one is forecast to have held steady at 0.9%. A small decline in the headline rate and an underlying print still well below 2% may add more credence to the view that ECB officials are unlikely to start considering withdrawing monetary policy support anytime soon. As for the rest of Wednesday's data, Asian time, Japan's preliminary industrial production for May and China's official PMIs for June are coming out. Japan's industrial production is expected to have shrunk 2.4% month over month after improving 2.9% in April, while with regards to the Chinese PMIs, we only have a forecast for the manufacturing index, which is expected to have declined fractionally to 50.8 from 51. During the European session, besides the Eurozone CPIs, we have the UK's final GDP for the first quarter and the German unemployment rate for June. The final UK GDP is just expected to confirm its preliminary estimate of -1.5% quarter over quarter, while Germany's unemployment rate is forecast to have ticked down to 5.9% from 6%. Later in the day, from the US, we get the ADP employment report for June and the pending home sales for May. The ADP report is expected to show that the private sector has gained 600,000 jobs in June, less than the 978,000 added in May. This could raise some speculation that the NFPs due out on Friday may come near their own forecast of 675,000. However, we will not rely much on the ADP report as it has been far from a reliable predictor of the NFPs. Even last month, when the ADP revealed a 978,000 job gain, the NFPs came in at 559,000. It seems that market participants agree with us, and this is evident by how insignificant market reactions have been to the ADP number in the last years. Pending home sales are expected to have slid 1% month over month in May, after tumbling 4.4% in April. From Canada, we get the monthly GDP for April, which is expected to reveal a contraction of 0.9% month over month after expanding 1.1% in March. However, we don't believe that any potential slide in the loonie due to that will be large and long-lasting. We believe that CAD traders may pay more attention to the OPEC Plus meeting scheduled for Thursday. Now, as we just noted, Thursday's main event is likely to be the OPEC Plus decision, which may decide the fate of oil prices and also affect oil-linked currencies, the likes of the Canadian dollar and the Norwegian krone. Media chatter suggests that the producers are likely to agree on another 500,000 barrels per day output increase starting from August, as the latest surge in oil prices gives them ample reasons to believe that the market can absorb this kind of an increase. Now, in terms of market reaction, we believe that a 500,000 barrels per day increase is unlikely to impact much the broader path of oil prices, As this is what is already telegraphed, then market participants are doubtful to get surprised. For oil prices to pull back, we think that a number well above 500K may be needed, which could, as I already said, this could result, a higher number could result a pullback in oil prices. Now, as for the rest of Thursday's events, during the Asian trading, we get Japan's Tankan survey for the second quarter, Australia's trade balance for May, and China's Kaijin manufacturing PMI for June. In Japan, both the large manufacturers and large non-manufacturers indices are expected to have increased to 18 and 3 from 4 and minus 1, while Australia's trade surplus is anticipated to have increased to 10 billion Aussies from 8.03 billion Aussies. China's Kaijin manufacturing index is forecast to have slid to 51.8 from 52. Now, later in the day, we have the final market manufacturing PMIs for June from the Eurozone, the UK and the US, as well as the ISM manufacturing index for the month. As it is always the case, the final market prints are expected to confirm their preliminary estimates, while the ISM index is expected to have declined fractionally to 61 from 61.2. Finally, on Friday, the spotlight is likely to turn to the US employment report for June. Non-farm payrolls are expected to have increased by 675K, more than May's 559K, while the unemployment rate is anticipated to have ticked down to 5.7% from 5.8%. Average hourly earnings are anticipated to slow somewhat in monthly terms, but the year-over-year rate is forecast to have surged to 3.6% from 2%, adding to fears that inflation may continue to fly well beyond the Fed's objective of 2%. In our view, such a report is likely to add to speculation that the Fed may indeed have to raise interest rates sooner than previously anticipated, something that that may support the US dollar. Oddly enough, although this means further progress in the world's largest economy, it could hurt equities as higher rates mean more expensive borrowing and lower present values for companies. Having said all that, though, the main driver behind the broader market sentiment is likely to stay in the signals and opinions from various Fed officials, in our view, as this paints a more direct picture with regards to what could happen next in terms of monetary policy. As for the rest of Friday's releases, we have Germany's retail sales, Canada's trade balance, and the US factory orders, all for May. Germany's data are anticipated is anticipated to show decent improvement, while Canada's trade surplus is forecast to have declined somewhat. US factory orders are expected to have rebounded after sliding in April. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. I hope you have a great week, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again next Monday. If you are interested in more detailed and frequent analysis, you can find me on our YouTube channel from Tuesday to Friday at around 7:30 a.m. GMT. So goodbye and have a nice day.
JFT, just fair and direct.